I'm here to talk about this study that we conducted around last year, on the same time last year, facilitated by UNICEF and conducted by a group of us at IIT Delhi. As the title says, our objective was really to look at some of the activities that are going on in this space of technology for development and how we could draw some valuable lessons from these activities so that whenever one is trying to, you know, go into this space, he can probably take some value from the lessons that we've drawn out and get his initiatives online. And so I'm going to talk about these initiatives and what we learned from them. But first of all, I want to say that technology for development is a tricky phrase. You know, technology itself is something difficult to define. And development also is something not very easy to define. And for me, development is something that you do so that it sort of enables more freedom to people, gives more freedom to people, and capacitates them. And we've all talked about how technology has sort of become inseparable from our lives and how we're all dependent on it and we can't do anything, we can't even imagine life without technology. But one can't help but say that it hasn't done enough for the marginalized. It hasn't done enough for those who really need it. And therefore, development hasn't been as inclusive as it should have been. But all is not bad, and there have been some good initiatives, and there is a reason for hope, there is reason for optimism. And so we looked at some of these initiatives that gave us that reason for hope and optimism, and we tried to learn from them. So what we did was we mapped out around 65 of these initiatives which were using technology, and our focus was more on ICTs, and we were using ICTs for development. And we took some lessons out of that, but we knew that to really, really connect with them, we need to form concrete stories. So we further shortlisted around 20 of them and made stories out of them and tried to see what the stories wanted to tell us. And before I go on to these lessons, I want to make it sort of relevant to this event here. And I want to talk about how mobiles can be used. And what you saw during the study was that a lot of these initiatives were moving from internet or moving from PCs or laptops to mobiles. And perhaps there is sense to that, because we know that mobiles have become ubiquitous. And there is obvious sense to that. And there are facts, like here, you can see that even internet traffic has now increased on mobiles than on desktops. And I think this is a wonderful fact, and this presents a wonderful opportunity to be used here. But there's a caveat. The caveat being that you can't just hand out technology and expect development or social change to happen. You have to think through it. And in that sense, a positive thing that we found out was that times were changing and they were changing for good. Because people moving on from mere initiatives where technology was handed out or laptops were handed out to children to something which was more thought out, to something which was more planned, wherein the technology was able to connect with the user itself. And the plans became more focused. On the left, you see a picture of Telecenter, which were becoming very, very popular when this field sort of started out, the field of ICT for Ds, in and around, let's say, the early part of the last decade. And what these initiatives were trying to do is sort of experiment, which is not a bad thing. But these experiments did not result in a very positive change. And what people understood was that they were not very focused, and they did not probably understand the users as much as they should have. And perhaps now we have changed to a model that is more understanding of the user, more focused, and has certain positive side to it. And I'm going to talk about these positive sides through the lessons that we learned. But these lessons might be reduced to mere words if I just talk about what the lessons are. And I think I should give you a story. And the story is of this organization called World Health Partners, who I hope some of you know, because I think it deserves to be known. And it's doing some very good work here. What this graphic really shows is how they work. So what they do is that the problem they're trying to tackle is that of bad health services that we right now have in the country, especially in places where there's no transport or where there's no communication as well sometimes. So what do you do with a place like that? And how do you provide services, health services, to a place like that? And even primary health services. So what they do is that they looked at how there were various systems already in place which could have helped them to deliver this model successfully. So first of all, they start with a primary health center. This is basically a quack sitting in a rural area. Now, a quack is something that a lot of people would berate, and a lot of people would, you know, condemn him and say that, you know, he shouldn't be here, and they would probably try and replace him with their own representative who can deliver a better service. But what these guys did is that they realized that the quack is useful because the community already trusts them. And when you train a person who's already trustworthy, you can probably get the community come to you rather than you trying to go to them. And it's one thing for you to try and help them, but it's another thing for them to accept your help. Because when you, as a person, I mean, when people like us go to villages, they can't expect that you can empathize with them. But when a quack who's already sitting there tries to tell them that there's something of benefit for them here, they can probably listen to him more than they can listen to us. And to make this model more successful, what they did was that you obviously realize that there are sometimes health problems that can't be catered by the quack, and he's not capacitated enough to help these people. So they partnered with more such organizations that could have helped them deliver this model. So they partnered with some health centers which were in Delhi or Patna, which could be reached through phones or through telemedicine. Now, to get a telemedicine in place, they further had more partners, one of them being Neurosynaptic Communications, which is a firm based in Bangalore, which has an expertise in telemedicine. They also partnered with pharmacies, which were already there, in and around these areas. So they did not build more pharmacies. They just partnered with the ones that were already there. And one of the problems that these pharmacies face while stocking the medicines that they have is that they always try to stock out as many medicines that they can, so that whenever the new stock comes, it's beneficial. I mean, they can take in as much stock as they can, and therefore they're trying to stock out all of the medicines first and then bring in the stock. So at a lot of times, you'll have a lot of shortage of some in-demand medicines. To tackle this problem, they found that there was already an organization called Logistimo, which has an expertise in last mile outreach and all, and they partnered with them. So what I'm trying to say is that all these guys did was figure out who were the experts in various fields and brought them together. And this brings me to the first lesson, which is building the right ecosystem and partnerships. If you're trying to do everything yourself, you're probably going to make it messy. And if there are already things in place, there's sense to using that. I'm going to move on to some of the other lessons that we found out. But while these lessons are written as different points, they're not independent, and they cross-cut each other. And you're going to see that while I talk about them. So the second point is to engage with the users. As I said, a lot of early initiatives like telecenters and, let's say, one laptop per child initiative, they did not really understand the users. I mean, you can give a laptop to a child, but if he doesn't understand the content, if he's not literate enough, it's useless for him. If he doesn't have the electricity to charge it, it's useless for him. If he can't relate to the content, it's useless for him. Therefore, it's important that you understand your users. You form a deeper connection with them. And perhaps that is what they were doing when they used the quack. They were trying to form a deeper connection with the community. And the third point here says, go hyperlocal. And hyperlocality is not a new thing. We've seen it from so many years. And we've seen it, for example, saying McDonald's or the Oreo cookie, which traditionally comes in this chocolate, vanilla chocolate layer. But if you go to Russia, you might taste caviar in that. If you go to China, you might taste green tea in that. And therefore, hyperlocality is not new. And it's something that we know that works. And here's a pic which shows work by an organization called Planet Read. And this pic is a snapshot of the national television. There's a show called Chitrar. I don't know how many of you remember it. But what's happening here is that a Hindi song is playing, and Hindi subtitles are here. Now, you have around millions of semi-literate users in India who had some amount of education, but due to economic constraints, they had to leave their education and go to work. Now, initiatives like these, which are enabling them to go back and work upon their literacy, And this is fun for them. I mean, they don't even see it as work. I mean, they just are murmuring the song along as it goes. And it's a, I think it's a simple idea, but it's a beautiful idea. Moving on to sustainability and scalability, it's more of a warning than a lesson. Because what we found during our study was a lot of organizations would have a brilliant idea, and they would even convince a funding agency to execute that idea. But a few years down the line, the idea would remain stagnant, and the funding agency would say that, oh, all right, we're going to move out now. We're going to move on to a different initiative. And the idea would be left there, even though it was working. So I think organizations need to plan their way and need to see that they are able to sustain themselves. And there's a very famous phrase here given by, I think, C.K. Prahlad, who said there was a fortune at the bottom of the pyramid to be used. And I know it doesn't work all the time, but I think there is some sense to that. And there is some sense to that if you're able to use it. Well, for example, a lot of these organizations, like even World Health Partners, what they do is that they realize that preventive healthcare is something that people don't pay for. But they do pay for curative healthcare, because that is something that's a priority. And this is what I mean by cross-subsidizing. You initiate something that can get you some money, some finances, so that you're also able to execute your other plans. And also sometimes you form symbiotic relations which can help you. For example, you're looking to execute an idea but don't have money for it, but there are corporates out there who are looking to execute their CSR initiatives, and they don't have a sense of what to do. I mean, sometimes they do, but a lot of times they don't. So you can probably leverage that here. And by sustainability, I don't want to restrict myself to finances. There's content as well, and that's very important. Because sometimes an organization will execute a plan, use a content, or deliver some information, and that might be useful today, but it might be useless tomorrow. And organizations just sometimes become stagnant with that, and they're not able to evolve. And it's very important to always monitor your content and see that it's relevant each and every time you go out there. Then you come to evaluation, and obviously evaluation is important, because if you don't, you're going to hit the blunt takes over and over, and it's not going to make a difference. But by evaluation, I don't mean merely counting. You can have a mobile app, and you can say that, okay, this app is functionable in 10 million mobiles, but you can't say that 10 million people are using your app. Because as this quote says, this is attributed to Einstein sometimes, and sometimes to this gentleman here, William Bruce Cameron. I wrote William Bruce Cameron first because there are a lot of quotes already attributed to Einstein. So probably there's justice to attributing this to him. But what I mean to say is that you've got to make sure that this is happening. This is social and behavioral change. You just can't state some numbers and say that you're successful. You've got to make sure that you're effective in what you're trying to do. And therefore you're going to map out your evaluation strategies so that you just don't come up with mere stats, but you come up with something that's able to prove that there is, in fact, a social and behavioral change and of the nature that you were trying to achieve. And finally, I come on to using technology smartly. As I said, you can't just hand out technology and expect change to happen. And you can't hand out any technology without thinking about the fact that is it useful or not. So therefore, you got to realize, how do you use technology smartly? And it doesn't always mean using very hardcore technology. You can use something as simple as a basic mobile phone and make games like that, which this picture shows. It's a snapshot of a game made by an organization called ZMQ Software, which I think also features in the draft paper that we have. What they do is that they make games that they think people can relate to. And obviously, this being India, people can obviously relate to cricket. And what they did was they made this game and used it to increase awareness about AIDS. And as I said, it's a simple idea, but it's a beautiful idea. And I think what we got to realize is that technology should not be used to replace what's already there. It should amplify our human forces. It should amplify the efforts that we're already making for development. And this is a picture that comes from a UNICEF report, and it's about how this community health worker is really empowered by a simple use of a mobile by interacting with people above him who are implementing the healthcare system and people along with him or her in the community. And it strengthens the social dynamics that are already there. And it makes sure that the system will be kept in place while it's only using a very simple technology that's mobile. And it's only using an SMS-based system or something like that. It's not even using complex stuff. And finally, I want to make some remarks some things that we found while we were doing this research was that there are a lot of gaps still left, in the sense that there's a lot of uneven sectoral and geographical distribution here. For example, there were almost none of the initiatives were working in Northeast, and people were still not reaching the marginalized, and they were still trying to make apps which would be enabled on a GPRS phone. I mean, the farmer would not have the GPRS. You got to realize that. And talking about the collaborative platform, I think this is a good place to talk about it, because I think this is one such platform. And what we also found that a lot of these organizations were actually intrinsically networked with each other. And perhaps their interaction had given them a sense of what's right and what's wrong and how to succeed in the place. And finally, I want to give two ideas that I think are important and simple, but a lot of people ignore it. One is persistence. Development is a messy and complicated process. You can't expect to be right in the first time. And therefore, you've got to be persistent. You've got to try things and you've got to see what works. And secondly, simplicity can work. I mean, we're talking about some big problems here: education, sanitation, healthcare. And I know these are complicated problems. But what we often do is assume that complicated problems have complicated solutions, while they may have very simple solutions. And a very simple idea can go very far. Thank you.